In this video, we'll discuss the design of the experiment that we'll be covering in this video tutorial series. We'll point out some components of the project that handle different aspects of the experiment as we go along, but this video is mostly intended to provide an overview of the methodological design. For more detailed information regarding the implementation of the various aspects of the design, please see the other videos in this series. This video tutorial series uses the Posner task to illustrate the fundamental concepts of Experiment Builder, with the idea being to show how things work in Experiment Builder in the context of a familiar task. This implementation of the Posner task illustrates how to present different stimuli on each trial, how to change characteristics of these stimuli, like their location, how to randomly set a variable which is used to control a timer's duration, how to randomize trial orderings and block orderings, and how to collect responses from participants and log data associated with these responses. While the specifics of other experimental paradigms will of course be different, the techniques illustrated in this example project can be generalized to other experimental paradigms. The idea is to illustrate building blocks and techniques and best practices that can be used when implementing any other task. The Posner task, or at least the simple version of it illustrated in this tutorial, presents a series of trials, each of which consists of a series of events. On each trial, the participant first is presented with a fixation cross with two placeholder boxes on the left and right. Then, a cue, which may be valid, invalid, or neutral, is presented centrally, near the fixation cross. After 500 milliseconds, the cue disappears, so that the screen appears as it did during the initial fixation cross. Following a randomly chosen duration, a target onsets in one of the two placeholder box areas. At this point, the participant should press one of two keys to indicate whether the target is on the left or right. On valid trials, the cue correctly indicates the side of the upcoming target. On invalid trials, the cue indicates the side opposite that of the upcoming target. On neutral trials, the cue does not provide information about the possible side of the upcoming target. The prediction is that participants will be quicker to detect targets that were preceded by a valid cue, as their attention will have been shifted to the target location by the cue. This directed attention may also speed eye movements to the target position following onset. Let's cover how this procedure is implemented as an EyeLink experiment in Experiment Builder. First, the project presents some simple camera setup and calibration instructions. Following these instructions, the camera setup action puts the host PC and display PC into a special camera setup mode so that you can set up the participant and calibrate the eye tracker. Following this, the experiment proceeds with three blocks of trials. At the beginning of the first block, the participant is given some instructions about what to do on each trial. Between blocks, the participant is presented with a screen prompting them to take a break. When the participant is ready, a key can be pressed to proceed from either of these instruction screens. Each block then proceeds with the trials for that block. The first block is a practice block consisting of two trials. The next two blocks are experimental blocks, each consisting of 10 trials. These each have 4 valid trials, 1 invalid trial, and 5 neutral trials. The block ordering is structured so that the practice trials always come first, but the order of the two experimental blocks is randomized. Within each block, the trial order is randomized. Each trial begins with some trial preparation, followed by a drift check procedure. Once this is complete, the eye tracker starts recording data and the trial's experimental events begin. First, the participant is shown a fixation cross and two placeholder boxes on the left and right sides of the screen. After 1,000 milliseconds, the queue appears and remains on the screen for 500 milliseconds, at which point it is removed. After a randomly chosen variable duration used to ensure stimulus onset asynchrony, the target appears and is presented for up to 5,000 milliseconds. During this period, the participant should press the Z key if the target is on the left or the slash key if the target is on the right. Following a response, feedback is immediately presented indicating whether the response was correct or incorrect. If a response is made, the accuracy of that response is also checked, and the values of some behavioral data variables are set to log the data associated with the response. If the participant does not press a key in 5 seconds, then the trial times out and presents some feedback telling the participant to go faster. The feedback at the end of the trial remains on the screen for 2 seconds, and then the trial ends with a blank screen. After the completion of all 22 trials, the experiment ends automatically, and the data file is transferred from the host PC to the display PC. We can do a test run to see what happens in the experiment. If we are not connected to a host PC, and hence an eye tracker, then we should go to the EyeLink section of the Devices tab of the Structure panel and check Dummy Mode. This will disable the eye tracking functionality of the project and make it so that it doesn't attempt to connect to a host PC when we run it. Once we have Dummy Mode on, we can go to Experiment Test Run to test the project. After the project builds, it will ask us for an EDF file name. We'll just use the default test.edf for now. Since we're in dummy mode, we'll get a heads up about that as well. It will then ask us which version or counterbalance of the project to use by asking us to choose a value for the counterbalance column of the data source, as there are 2 counterbalanced versions of the experiment that have been implemented in this one experiment builder project. Once we choose a version, the run will begin and we'll see the eye tracker setup instructions. From here, we would typically press a key to go into camera setup mode, which would allow us to set up the participant and calibrate the eye tracker. Since we're in dummy mode, the camera setup mode, as well as other eye tracker functionality, like the drift check at the beginning of each trial, will be automatically disabled and skipped. For instructions on participant setup with the eye tracker, please see links to eye tracker setup and usage learning materials in the description below. Once we press a key, we'll see the block instructions, and we can press a key to progress from here to begin the trials. The participant will proceed through each trial, and once a trial ends, the next trial will automatically begin. After the 2 practice trials, we'll see the break screen that will be presented between blocks. We can press any key on the display PC to move on from here to the next block of trials. Since this is just a test run and we don't want to proceed through the rest of the trials, we can press Ctrl C on the display PC to end the experimental run. Ctrl C is the best method for ending an experiment builder run early, as it will ensure that the participant's EDF file is retrieved from the host PC and the connection to the host PC is properly shut down. We don't have an EDF file or connection to the host PC in this case because we're in dummy mode, but Ctrl C is still the best way to end a run if you need to quit early before the experiment finishes. You can end runs this way both when doing test runs and when doing real data collection with a deployed experiment builder project.